Father God, with awe and wonder we worship you. You are all-powerful, ever-present, shaping the pattern of history, transforming our lives. You are all-good, ever-merciful, showering us with your blessings and forgiving us our faults. You are always true, ever-constant. You are holy, ever perfect, just and righteous in all you do. So for this morning, we worship and we adore you. Would you open our eyes afresh to your splendor, our hearts to your love, our minds to your purpose, and our spirits to your presence. And so may we celebrate the wonder of all that you are, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. We now turn to Singing of the Faith, number 820. It's a psalm, Psalm 98. And I'll read the light if you'd like to read the dark. Okay. I'll read it. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have gained him victory. The Lord has made known his victory. He has revelled his vindication in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his steadfast love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the victory of our God. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth in joyous song and sing praises. Sing praises to the Lord with the lyre and the sound of melody. With trumpets and the sound of horn, make a joyful noise before the King, the Lord. Let the sea roar and all that fills it, the world and those who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands, let the hills sing together for joy at the presence of the Lord, for he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with equity. And so we turn to Singing of the Faith, number 628, Faithful One, So Unchanging. And if we could sing that through twice as well, please, Ruth. In footballing terms, this is a service of two halves. The first half is basically prayer, and the second half is sermon. In this first half, we're going to have our prayers of confession, and then I'll do a reflection on the Lord's Prayer, and then we're going to have a song and prayers of remembrance. But just before we go into the prayers of confession, back in 1974, Leslie and I were on our honeymoon in Kenya, and our father-in-law was there as well. I think he was keeping an eye on me at the time. Anyway, he took us to this lodge, and as he parked his car, so he hit a rock, and an African gentleman came running round, and he apologised for this rock hitting my father-in-law's car. And that got me thinking a bit that sometimes our prayers of confession, they're not really a corporate prayer. They should be an individual prayer. And so what I'm going to do is give time and space for you to share your own prayers of confession. I'll lead us into it and take us out of it. But it'll be a time of quiet where you share with God your own prayers of confession. So let's pray together. Father God, aware of your majesty and power, we become aware of the things we've done wrong and those that we've not done in accordance with your will. And so we bring before you our own prayers of confession. And Father, would you enable us to accept your forgiveness and move into the future knowing that your forgiveness is complete. Amen. And so we continue our prayers with a reflection on the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, Lord, would you have asked us to call you our Father. For you are Father of all. We come to you as children, knowing you long to hear from us and long to reveal more of yourself to us. We pray for those to whom the word Father has been spoilt by their experiences of an imperfect earthly father. May they come to know your true your fatherhood as something good, safe, and secure. Would you enable us to grow in understanding of your fatherhood and never take relationships with you for granted? Hallowed be your name. Lord God, we hallow your name. We call you holy. For that is what you are. We pray that every time we use your name, it will be with an awareness of who you are. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord God, we pray for your will to be done and for your kingdom to come. Would you help us to understand what that really means for us in our lives? Would you give us the courage to do your will? And give us this day our daily bread. Lord God, we pray for all that we need to live each day. Food for body, mind, and spirit. We pray for those who are finding it difficult to provide the food and heat they need just to live. Father, would you encourage those who have to give to those who haven't? And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lord God, we confess our sins to you. Forgive us, we pray, and restore us into a right relationship with you. We pray when we find it difficult to forgive. We pray that we will try and seek forgiveness. We pray that we will continue to seek forgiveness. Forgiveness can be hard. We know you to be a forgiving Father. So, Lord, would you teach us how to forgive each other that we may live in harmony and be restored into a right relationship with you and each other. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Lord God, I'm afraid to say we can so easily be led astray, so easily tempted. We ask that in our attempt to follow you, that you will give us the encouragement and strength so that we can stand up to being tempted. And we pray for those who've given in to temptation and feel lost and devastated. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Amen. We turn now to Singing the Faith. Songs of Fellowship, number 664, Beauty for Brokenness. So we're going to have to close. All right, we've been binging and bonging. Oh, so we're having to close down. Are we okay to sing a song? Oh no, right. It's 664, number 664. In Songs of Fellowship. Songs of Fellowship. Songs of Fellowship, 664. Yeah. Right, we're back.
Thank you.
Right, after that bit of excitement, let's just calm down. Especially me, calm down. And let's pray together. There's a prayer of remembrance. God, our Father, on this day of remembrance, we bring before you our prayers of remembrance, trusting in your unfailing love. We think about war and its effects. Remember wars of the past, the people involved, the pain and loss caused, and the ongoing legacy for those who fought, those who lost loved ones, and those who still struggle physically and emotionally because of the effects of war. God, our Father, we struggle to understand. Would you help us to trust in your unfailing love? God, our Father, on this day of remembrance, we think about war and its effects. We remember present wars, in particular, what's happening in Ukraine at the moment. We pray for those who are affected by it, the people who've lost family, friends, homes, a way of life. And we think of those who are struggling physically and emotionally. God, our Father, we struggle to understand. Would you help us to trust in your unfailing love? And God, our Father, on this day of remembrance, we pray for peace. We pray for peace among nations. We remember those who are struggling with mental illness. We remember people who are struggling with their family relationships. We ask for peace, your peace, a lasting peace that will show how we can live together in harmony with each other. God, our Father, we struggle to understand. Would you help us to trust in your unfailing love? So, God, our Father, on this day of remembrance, we think about peace. We want to commit ourselves afresh for working for peace in all situations. Would you encourage each one of us to know the right actions that we might know true peace? God, our Father, we struggle to understand. Would you help us to trust in your unfailing love? God, our Father, on this day of remembrance, we think about your Son, Jesus, who came to show us the way, your way of peace. And so we offer our prayers through Jesus Christ our Lord, who through his unfailing love shows us and encourages us to live in peace with one another. Amen. We come now to our time of silence, our 2 minutes, I was corrected, our 2 minutes silence. So those of you who are able, if you'd like to stand, and we will have a 2 minute time of silence together.
like to repeat the words on the screen together. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. Thank you. Now, hopefully, if the words are on the screen, we'll turn to Singing the Faith, number 132, O God, Our Help in Ages Past. Now we start the second half with our reading.
Our reading this morning is taken from Luke chapter 1, verses 5 to 19, the destruction of the temple and the signs of the end times. Some of his disciples were remarking about how the temple was adorned with beautiful stones and with gifts dedicated to God. But Jesus said, "As for what you see here, the time will come when not one stone will be left on another. Every one of them will be thrown down." "Teacher," they asked, "when will these things happen? And what will be the sign that they are about to take place?" He replied, "Watch out that you are not deceived, for many will come in my name, claiming, "I am he, and the time is near. Do not follow them. When you hear of wars and uprisings, do not be frightened. These things must happen first, but the end will not come right away." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, famines, and pestilences in various places, and fearful events and great signs from heaven. But before all this, they will seize you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and put you in prison, and you'll be brought before kings and governors, and all on account of my name. And so you will bear testimony to me. But make up your mind not to worry beforehand how you will defend yourselves, for I will give you words and wisdom that none of your adversaries will be able to resist or contradict. You will be betrayed, even by parents, brothers and sisters, relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. Everyone will hate you because of me, but not a hair of your head will perish. Stand firm, and you will win life." Amen.
Thank you, Lindsay, for reading that with us. It just struck me that the start of the service, or just beginning the service, we were talking about a new build. And in the reading, we're talking about demolition. Let's pray together. Father God, would you open our hearts and minds to what you would have to say to each one of us this morning. Amen. I keep a daily journal. It's something I've done since I retired. Recently, my granddaughter discovered on the desk in my study my journal. She asked Grandma if she could have a look inside. Grandma, who never looks inside it, said yes, it should be okay. I think Grandma wanted to find out if there's anything in there. But she said, "I don't think Grandma keeps any secrets in the journal." After she read it for a while, she said, "Grandma, it says he does exercises each morning. What are they?" "Well, Granddad gets on the floor and stretches his back and his legs." "Grandma?" "Yes, Lois." "Isn't Granddad a bit too old for doing exercises on the floor?" The reason I'm telling you this is because this week, as I've been doing my exercises, I've been grappling with today's reading. It's not easy being a local preacher or a minister, especially when faced with the Bible passage that we've had read to us this morning. And of course, here at HHMC, there's the added pressure of having to provide the worship material on the Wednesday before the service. So you're under quite a bit of pressure to get something sorted out. So where do we start? This is one of those readings that might have been thrown back at you when discussing with someone what it means to you to follow Christ. "I thought your Jesus said, the time is near. When you hear of wars and revolutions, when these things happen, the end will come." Well, over the past 2,000 years, there have been many wars, many nations rising against each other, many earthquakes, many famines. There's plenty of opportunities there for Jesus to have made a second coming, but he hasn't. Yes, but it does say The end will not come right away. In Luke 21, verse 5, the account starts with, some of the disciples were remarking about how the temple was adorned with beautiful stones and with gifts dedicated to God. The reading is a continuation of Jesus with his disciples as they moved into the temple in Jerusalem. Jesus rides into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey. He visits the temple area and is angry at what he finds. He drives out the people selling money. He and the disciples then spend a number of days in the temple courts, teaching and preaching. Luke chapter 20, verse 1 says, one day he was teaching to the people in the temple courts. The chief priests and teachers of the law were beginning to get upset and asked, with what authority was he teaching and preaching? It's as though over a period of a few days, Jesus and his disciples moved deeper and deeper into the temple courts. And then they are right next to the temple itself, looking up at this magnificent structure that was nearing completion. I can imagine the disciples standing there with expressions of amazement on their faces as they observed the temple, the size, the structure, the stonework, and the contrasting colours. As many of you know, Leslie, my wife, enjoys cruising holidays. I just tag along and pay the bills. I have to say, I also enjoy them as well. I enjoy travelling around. We're very fortunate that we can do that. And on our travels, we've visited many iconic religious buildings. St. Peter's Basilica in Rome, the Blue Mosque in Istanbul, the Cathedral of Santa Maria in Florence, Notre Dame in Paris before it was burnt down, the Temple of Karnak in Egypt, Angkor Wat in Cambodia, La Sagrada Familia in Barcelona, and there's been many others. One thing I've noticed when we've been going around on these trips is when we go into sort of large cities, the first thing that many visitors do is go to the churches and the cathedrals, which I find rather strange because there's very few people go to church these days, and yet these places draw the crowds. Something to think on, maybe. But when I reflect on my visit to these buildings and think back to when I entered these buildings for the first time, I probably had the same feeling as those disciples had when they observed the temple in the Jerusalem. But there's always a question I have when I visit these places is, how did they do that? How was that magnificent roof structure built? How were those huge stone lintels lifted into place? I think sometimes when we go into these places, we take for granted that these buildings have been there forever, and we don't always appreciate the effort and time that's gone into the construction of these places. The temple and the disciples, the temple the disciples were admiring was not Solomon's temple. Solomon's temple had been destroyed by the Babylonians in the 7th century BC. The temple had been built by Ezra after the return from exile in the 6th century BC. It was desecrated by the Seleucids in the 2nd century BC and reconstructed by the Maccabees soon afterwards, and that it was enormously expanded by Herod the Great over a 46-year period. In fact, when Jesus and the disciples visited, there were probably some building works actually taking place. It was a beautiful, imposing structure with a significant history, but Jesus said it would be completely destroyed. And of course it was in 70 AD when the Roman army demolished it. But that's enough of the history. So back to our reading. We live in a world where we think things will last forever. A forever home is a wish for many people. There are television programs where we see people looking for a home that they can develop and provide comfort for themselves and their families across the different stages of their lives. When Jesus told the disciples the temple would be destroyed, they would have been shocked. As they looked at this massive structure of the temple, they would possibly imagined it as a permanent, forever temple, a temple that would always be there. I often wonder why it is in the church there is so much resistance to change when Jesus himself was at the very heart of change. And it seems to me that Jesus was upset with the way the temple was being used, the malpractices that were taking place within its walls, the financial distortion that was ongoing, the fact that God was housed in the most holy place in the center of the temple and could only be accessed by certain people, namely the high priest. Jesus was announcing the imminent demise of the God's temple. So was Jesus suggesting the temple had fulfilled its various roles within the Israel, at the heart of the nation, the place of forgiveness, and the location of God's presence? Was Jesus himself now going on to fulfill these roles among the people, with himself being the true center and the access point to God, rather than the temple? Pondering over these readings, as I was doing my exercises this last week, there's 2 points that I would like to share with you. In verse 7 to 8, the disciples asked, when will these things happen, and what will be a sign? Jesus replied, watch out, and watch out you're not deceived. Don't worry, Jesus said, I will give you words of wisdom. Just be careful you're not deceived by others. Please carry on to witness. Don't just sit around waiting for the end. I came across this interpretation in The Message. Jesus talking to his disciples. You'll think at the time that the very sky is falling in, but before any of this happens, they'll arrest you, hunt you down, and drag you to court and jail. It will go from bad to worse, dog eat dog, everyone at you, everyone at your throat because you carry my name. You'll end up on the witness stand, called to testify. Make up your mind right now, not to worry about it. And I will give you words of wisdom that will reduce all your accusers, prosecutors, persecutors, to stammers and stutters. Stuttered my way through that, didn't I? There are a number of times recorded in the book of Acts where Luke writes about the disciples being persecuted. One in particular in Acts chapter 5, the apostles were arrested by the high priest and Sadducees and put in prison. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the doors and the prison and let the apostles out. The apostles were told by the angel not to run away, but to stand in the temple courts and tell the new message of life, which they did. When he stood looking at the temple building with his disciples, Jesus told them they would be persecuted for following him. "Don't be put off. Continue to witness," Jesus said. "Stand firm." Here was one occasion when the disciples did exactly what Jesus had told them to do. Now, we may not experience the same level of persecution that those disciples were experiencing. However, we may encounter forms of persecution. It seems to me that Jesus here is encouraging each one of us to stand firm. Stay with it. Verse 19, "By standing firm, you will gain life." You may be going through a rough patch in your life. Jesus says, stay with it. You may be going through a time of loss in your life. Jesus says, stay with it. You may be going through a time of doubt in your life. Jesus says, don't worry, stay with it. You may be struggling with an ongoing health problem. Jesus says, stay with it. All these and many other issues come between your faith and your relationship with Jesus. And thinking about it, they can almost be a form of self-persecution, or maybe internal persecution. You may be sitting there hearing these words, stay with it, stand firm, and thinking for yourself, well, it's easy for you to do that, to say these things, but at this moment in time, for me, things might not be going that well. In fact, they're pretty awful. And I'm not sure where God is at this time in my life. That's what you might be thinking to yourselves. And if you are feeling this way, speak to those around you, because those around you may have gone through similar experiences. And you never know, when you speak to someone else, you might receive a word of wisdom from God in your conversation. Jesus says, stay with it. By standing firm, you will gain life, said Jesus. Amen. Let's pray together. There's a song we sometimes sing. I don't think we've sung it for a while, actually, where the lines are, "We shall stand with our feet on the rock. Whatever men may say, we'll lift your name on high." And in the second verse, there is the following line, "Lord, as your witnesses, you have appointed us." Lord, would you encourage each one of us to live out the words of this song? Amen. I realise I haven't said hello to those who are listening afar. Have we got anybody who's been... Hello, Caroline, and hello, Christine. I'm not really seeing you, but nice for you to see us. And hello to anybody else. How deep the Father's love for us. We sing our final song together from Songs of Fellowship, number 780. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for all the many gifts that you give to us. Would you please accept the gifts of money that have been given through standing orders and that have been offered in the plate at the back of the church? Would you please accept them and ensure they're used for your work within this church and within this community? And we thank you for the time of worship together that we've had together this morning. And as we leave this place, may each of us be a blessing within and beyond this church community. And so we ask that you be with each of us as we leave this place. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Saviour.